zoning districts. Jeff Bagg from CMRPC is here, and he's going to make a presentation, and you going to present with him, or?
No, I'm just.
Your assistant, yes. Should we come on up?
Thank you. My name is Jeff Bagg, I'm a principal planner at Central Mass Regional Planning Commission, and this is Ronak Marathi, and she's the planning assistant, she's going to be participating in the project as we go. Ronak has a master's degree in public administration and some architectural background experience, which we're really excited to have with us at CMRPC. I've been with the agency for about a year, and I took over the Village Center zoning project from Eric Smith, and I've been working with Chris Ryan, who's the program manager there. So I know you guys are somewhat familiar. My understanding is that the last time this was before you formally was January 2016. What I have is a PowerPoint that Eric gave for sort of an assessment, where he had done some inventory work on a study area.
Well, sort of scoped out the area too, when we walked around to see where it should be.
Yes. So I think that that is a place where I think we can jump off from, but one of the things that I want to do was come here and just have a, what I was hoping to do is ask you guys for input, whether that area still makes sense, were there particular goals or things that you were interested in, and that way we can go back and flesh out some concepts and ideas. And then before we leave, what I can do is run through this presentation that I put together that kind of captures some of the concepts of the Village Center zoning and some of the options.
We have one new member.
Okay.
Paul, how familiar are you, Paul, with village zoning kind of
overlays or?
Well, we haven't decided whether it's an overlay, well, that's two questions.
So are you familiar with it?
Yes, yes. Because I was going to ask you to do a little review if you want.
What do we have in place now?
Anything? We don't have.
Just business and residential and commercial, things are zoning districts.
Right.
We don't really have a village zoning.
Okay.
And the only difference is our business district allows residential use. So it seems that almost makes it a village use, but the problems we've run into, which is where we're calling in CMRPC, is we have trouble with how to limit the uses that are desirable next to someone's house.
Right.
And parking. How to make things work so that there's enough parking, but not too much so that it's going to squeeze on the lot that's a half an acre. Because the area we're talking about is small lot sizes. So it's a lot of trying to work it all together.
And so, is there a way for you to give a recap of how far along you felt you got with Eric's work? So you did a sidewalk and
I think everybody was on the sidewalk, and we walked around all the way from, well, all over town. And we walked, where did we start? We started here. I think we walked all the way down to.
Down to the river, not the railroad tracks. We went down to Central and Goodale Streets.
Yeah. Did we get up to the school too?
Nope. We just went up to Goodale, looped back around.
Way around.
So we went down to Central.
Okay. We came all the way back down 140, almost to the train tracks.
Oh yeah. Well, we went Crescent and we went up to Newton, Prospect to Newton, and then back down by the library.
Yep.
And then across all the way down to the railroad tracks in the southern part.
Right. Okay, and then this is probably how we generated this preliminary map, the boundaries. And so, you know, the general synopsis right now is that there are three zoning districts. So the yellow is the general residence.
Okay.
So yeah.
I think what he was talking about.
And then the white is the single family residence, and then the purplish color is the business zoning.
Yes.
So that was what I was hoping to just find out. I mean, there's a variety of different things that you, I think, can be done with the Village Center zoning. Some of it has to do with, I think, like Vinny said, the types of uses that are going to go in buildings. So it's really looking at the buildings that exist and making sure that your zoning allows uses to come and go, the uses that you desire to come and go within the existing. there's another sort of set of criteria that can be used if you are talking about a vacant site. So one thing, as I, when I came, I was just kind of driving around to get myself a little familiar, and there's a property right here, 114 Central Street, has a big available.
Oh, yes.
For sale.
Yep.
It's a white,
yep.
Older, oh, white warehouse.
On the corner?
Yeah.
The former Cumberland Farms.
Yes.
Oh, right. Okay. Before we write them out. We pushed them somewhere else. To
a better site.
The public did.
Yeah, so they had public hearings and everything.
They got to the public hearings. And they were putting the site that's up, it's Cumberland Farms that you probably passed number 12. Same kind of situation, but they were trying to put it on a lot that was
almost
by half the size.
One of those huge stores in the village, so.
Yes. And right behind the honey farm, which I think was also puzzling to a lot of people.
Because what I was looking at just driving around is one of the things that I would do with you is look at a parcel like that and just test it to see what other uses could go there with the existing zoning. And it sounds like gas station is not necessarily a desirable one.
But it could. I think they needed a ZBA permit, and they were in.
And the zoning,
would allow it. There wasn't a. It was a citizen protest more than a zoning problem.
Right.
Well, I think Jeff was talking about, well, we could for uses that it's just some ideas of ways that, because everyone would love to have a certain use next to them. I'm not sure what that use is, but
the gold factory.
There's only so many of those. There's only so many, so we have to have enough to make it worthwhile. Because that's the other question I still have is, do we really even need to have a village zoning district?
After we did our walk around, I was sort of on the fence too.
Okay.
And I thought that maybe what this project was going to morph into was a straighten out our current zoning issues, you know,
right.
And straighten out the zoning down there. Like there's some places in the old kitchen store, the post office, then the kitchen store.
All these local places. Yeah. It's
And that sort of is a funny sort of building right on the, maybe even halfway into the residential zone. That's right.
Across from
yeah.
Across. And how familiar when we give the names of these places, you know any of them?
If it's not on the map, I'm not familiar.
I think it's another available property.
It's across from the that little plaza.
Yeah,
it's right.
I did my best to
get myself shadows.
Prospect.
Yeah.
It's a great thing.
Okay. Yeah, I had marked the two small businesses that are in the house. There's
yeah.
Like a photo shop or water.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. The same.
Oh well, those
street.
Are those
yeah.
Are the ones sort of at the end of that. And
okay.
Then
the plaza
here.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
So we have this area here. Some of my thoughts are, do we need a village district or we just change the business district and make this all a business district?
Right.
We want to try
that. That's sort of where I was. Sort of the same thing is maybe village zoning is kind of covered by what we're trying to, what we have in town already. We can sort of just fine tune what we got or go all the way to the whole new zoning bylaw.
A lot of people at that ZBA meeting were talking about the types of businesses that were here. Photo gallery or
yeah.
Architect or something like that, which didn't generate a lot of traffic. That was reasonable for a mixed business residential area like the center town is, and the
mm-hmm.
fact that the huge convenience store with
right,
huge
commercial
and air conditioning units right outside people's bedroom windows was not really an appropriate use
right.
For
yeah.
The village, and it would be great if we could
limit that.
Get some
yes,
right. Limit that to reasonable types of businesses in the center of town.
Yes.
And that's
right, and it's a tough one.
Well, you know.
The hardest part I think is when I was just driving around, I mean, so going out West Boylston Street, you hit the Walmart area and everything.
Yeah.
And it's the same business zoning district.
Yes.
And so that is usually the problem with when you get to what you might call like the highway business zoning. Areas, right, and then
exactly.
If you get close into your down here where the common is, or in this area where you said the small shops were, you know, that's where it makes sense to look a little harder. Whether you would want to consider some kind of overlay that would apply to a little area that would maybe close down or refine the types of uses that would be allowed there and tailor it a little bit more.
So yeah, because that makes sense, because we've got that situation, but it's not just on Crescent Street, it's also on Route 12.
Yes.
Because there's not a lot of space in there to put in a, like a big box store or anything like that. So that, we could try to keep that whole center area as village.
Right.
And whether we call it Business 2 or Village District, I don't know that it really matters. It's
right.
More how we frame it and how we shape it.
Yes.
But I know that there's a couple of business uses that are in these lots that are general residence districts that have tried in the past to change or modify the zoning. So I know that a couple of those people would be happy if you could adjust that zoning.
Like bed and breakfast over there?
Bed and breakfast, the Reservoir Garage, the...
What are they going
to
change?
Quilt shop business. It's now general residence. So they needed to get a special permit or variance.
Oh, in order to be there.
To be there. So they would rather get it by right.
Yeah. Okay.
How long does it take to walk from here to here? Just from
four minutes.
Wait,
I mean,
no.
I think when we did it, it took us, what, an hour to do the whole thing?
Yeah.
An hour and a half?
Just from, I have a background in urban design, and from that aspect, it is really important to encourage people to walk.
Yeah.
When they walk, they would have a destination. These two districts are really separated.
Yeah.
Is it really important?
I mean, there's a library there and everything. I mean, it is a nice place to walk.
Yes, there is.
The library is right there.
Right. There are there's areas in between the two shops that are here could be destinations.
Yeah.
You have
well,
the comments.
And then there's a
local
shop.
Right. The local.
Where's Franklin Street? I don't know.
Franklin's
right
up
here.
Where is it?
It's not far from that.
Franklin is this one here. This is
yes.
Where Town Hall is.
Town Hall
corner here, right?
Okay.
But we've got the post office right up here.
Yep.
You've got Darby's Bakery. Everyone stops in there in town for things up in that area.
And then market.
The library is right in the corner.
So do you allow that people sit outside of that,
yep.
For example?
Yeah.
That is great.
Yeah. I don't think Darby's just has that bench. But as far as we would love to have a more pedestrian-friendly place, you know, where you could walk from there, clear up to, you know, the other end of wherever. I mean, I don't think you'd get all the way to Walmart, but, you know.
Yeah, it's not that far.
I mean, no, there's no sidewalks or anything.
I live up here on Newton.
That's a house for walking.
That's what I mean. I would love to make it more pedestrian-friendly all the way up through there, you know.
So I'm in this area here.
Especially since you take the bus in here. The last stop on the bus line is at Walmart.
Right
now they have to walk on the grass
or in the street,
between there and the center of town.
So complete streets, we were looking at connecting the sidewalk to go all the way up to the Walmart.
What I saw in a very quick sort of first blush was that there is a natural center area here that is definitely worth looking at, whether there are aspects of the village center concepts that would work here. My first reaction was where Worcester Street and Maple Street come together.
Yep.
Everything past that towards, there is one sort of commercial, to me that was too far. We did work in Upton, which had some similarities here, and we learned that there's a benefit to being a little bit more compact with focusing this idea. I think going past where, so there's Honey Farms and Express up here, I think, and where Franklin Street comes through, I think going past Franklin Street would be too much because it drastically changes character over there, and I think to consider moving forward with a smaller, compact area will be hard enough, I think, because you'll have to make sure that the property owners, there'll be an educational process with the property owners, and it sounds like there might be some support.
But I think the residential people will be the ones concerned.
Right.
You know, I mean,
that's what we got.
Brenda, who's kind of on the edge down this end.
Yeah.
We had a couple
people
show up, because we posted that we were going to walk and look at village zoning, and then the draft that was put forth from Eric.
Yeah, but it was a generic draft statewide. It had bars and restaurants and
encouraged three-story buildings.
Yes, and we want to tailor it so that doesn't happen.
Right, and we just didn't whatever, edit the draft.
Well, so what we got was we got a lot of feedback from the people who did not want to see that mass like build up.
Yeah, they didn't want to see small office buildings and, you know.
And we noticed that there are a lot of businesses there. I don't know that we really need to have more business because we've got a lot of business space that isn't utilized. I don't know what the vacancy rating is, but that is something that we would want to look at least in this area, and say, okay, well, do we need to have more businesses?
Leaders and sort of figure out sort of what sort of character we were going for and try to, you know, make it conducive to those kind of businesses.
Yeah, that's the idea.
I mean, like, make it good for pedestrian access to coffee shops or something like that. I don't know, yoga shops, you know.
You certainly can do that. And when I get to the presentation, the PowerPoint that I have, this is reminding me of Upton, but on a smaller scale. So Upton had these two ends of commercial activity that they were interested in focusing on, and then they had a corridor in the middle that was mostly residential. And what we did with that was created a more, slightly more intense types of businesses in the existing commercial areas, and then created a transitional zone in the middle. So something that would be tailored to fit sort of the existing buildings in the middle, allow maybe some of the flexibility that you had mentioned with the quilt shop or a B&B, to give them the modest flexibility here, and then make sure you have the commercial.
We sort of have to be careful because there is a bed and breakfast and there is a shop there, so we can't out zone them out.
No, but it sounds like that might be desirable.
Oh, certainly.
Right, and to make it easier for them to either modify or have more of the same thing. So that's definitely a concept that works. When I took over from Eric, we worked pretty hard in Upton, and then it's in the kind of Sutton, which everyone conjures up different images, but when you are off of 146, you get off 146 and you go up the hill to the Sutton Town Center, where Sutton Town Hall is, and you have a beautiful town common, and it's, you're like in a different place. And so what they focused on was up there, creating an overlay district that was sort of very rural in nature, and they really just wanted to help revitalize two important properties. And so that actually passed town meeting in Sutton. And so I'm going to pull that in as sort of a reference or example that we can use for a successful overlay district. And then the other discussion is, do you just rezone, do you create a different district other than business? And so we can flesh that out a little bit.
Yeah, because I think we're looking for how it's all going to fit, and then I think we can work it in as an overlay or a zoning change, either way. But once we decide,
I think that's the second choice. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, obviously, it might be helpful to go through your presentation a little bit, because that might spark some other thoughts.
Yeah, so let's do that. And the only other question I have before I go into that is, if we're, you know, in July now, what is your fall town meeting schedule? Do you think that you would
make
public, right? So
it has to be underway with public hearings and public forums.
Yeah, okay.
And we usually don't do zoning changes in the spring.
Okay.
So it's probably a year and a half or a year and a couple months away.
The way the program is going to work, so through the DLTA funding, so that's what, when I was working with Chris Olson, that's how we kind of formulated it. It's a modest amount of funding to get through sort of, I would call this probably a two-stage process. The first stage would be between now and December to formulate the concept, formulate a proposed map of some sort, and have at least one public meeting with some stakeholders or something, and make sure that you're getting buy-in and support, and then what happens with DLTA is it ends in December, and then, assuming the state budget passes, we'll get another funding source that starts in like January or February, so we want to pick that back up and then work with you over the summer to set it up.
Chris was also talking about a grant for village zoning or something that was...
That's what this is, so that's what's bringing us here is I'm going
to
be working...
Okay, and that runs out and we have to keep going with some other... town funding.
Yeah, or wait till the next round of the grant funding comes back up. We're interested in staying with towns to see it to town meeting.
Yeah.
It's just the timing, and you know, I was a town planner in Amherst for a bunch of years, and so I know the town meeting process can be a little challenging, but Upton got to a point where the planning board felt like there was quite a bit of resistance to the concept, and so they kind of backed off, whereas Sutton kept moving forward and then ultimately passed it at town meeting. So I'll be pulling that example in. And I think that's...
Well, the planning board is used to resistance.
That happens. The other thing was what Chris had talked about doing, and you mentioned it earlier, which reminded me of it, was to evaluate the existing uses and the violations for... Because I think our zoning is 1 acre zoning.
Yeah. Something like that.
20-foot.
The thing that sticks out to me is that that building across from Darby's. There's something up with that building across from Darby's, like it's, I don't know, actually in Preston.
Pharmacy.
Yeah, it's not, it's the way the property works out is not quite right. Right. Yeah.
So what, is it too small or is it in the wrong?
It might be in a property that's too small, but I think it's too close to the neighbor or something like that. Like this, I forget what the problem was, but something stuck out to me.
Is it within this area here?
Is
there any business there besides the chiropractor?
This is the road. It's a big dentist. And it's just a little... You know, a nothing building, it's just a block building.
It happens still there, isn't it?
Cool. I think so.
Doctor, yeah.
It might be the line that we draw right here, it crosses this line.
That's right.
You know, or this line. It's too far into, it's in the residential, it should be...
Yeah, adjusting the lines.
I think that's what mainly what it was, would be moving those lines around, just so the zoning, you know, doesn't cause somebody to have a violation. It's
exactly
on their property.
So once we do it, the lines would try to match the lot lines that are there, or potentially future lot lines if there's a big parcel that could be used with an abutting one. But I think in the zoning, I don't know that we have a single 1 acre lot there in that area or 120 feet of front.
Exactly. And that was, I know that that's a lot of the research that Eric had done.
So he said he was working on that.
And yes, and I think he put together a series of findings that would lead to either an overlay or a new zoning district reducing the size of lot requirements so that it actually met the characteristics. And that's like a hallmark.
I'm not sure about that idea, that we don't need a village zoning, we just need to fix what we got.
Well, we need a new district.
It sounds like that would be how we can have a business district that's separate from a Walmart kind of business
district. Yes, right. You either create a new district or the overlay. The problem with trying to fix the business district is that I would imagine
it's
this
more
extends out and there's probably other business districts in your town. So if you change something desirable for here, it also changes it out there. That's more challenging because you're opening up.
Yep.
So I think what I can do is go through this pretty quick, and I have it available. This is an evolution of our project. What we are saying.
He was looking at the lights.
There's some lights, but I guess we'll put you like this.
I guess to give you the full picture, we're working with you. We're going to be working with the town of Holden and the town of Auburn to do this. We're doing three towns to move the village center concept forward, and then we're going to finalize a model village bylaw. Some model design guidelines, and where we're at now is moving forward with the towns and then using our experiences to inform the models, which we hope to have done by December. So it'll correspond with something if we resurrect the project after the winter, the models will be in place to help educate members of your town. So just in general, a lot of people ask, why would you do this? And there's basic principles, and there's a lot of variability, but these are the big picture concepts. But it could provide new economic development opportunities and create a greater vibrancy in certain areas. And so the idea is to make village centers more competitive in your town and in the region. And it creates opportunities for growth of existing businesses and new businesses. So there's a lot of desire to foster those existing businesses and allow more of the businesses that you want in a certain area. The what looks a little wordy, but it's a village scale zoning district, and a lot of times it's focused on sort of the existing infrastructure or existing buildings. There are some applications for this that could be applied to highway business types of areas that would look, you know, 10, 20 years down the road for when someone finally redevelops the property, you pull the buildings up to the road, and you know, you switch things around. That's more of a clean slate approach. So the second line is create new development, and there's a lot of focus on redevelopment that's more traditional in terms of design, scale, mix of uses, and character, especially visual character. So the third one is there is usually a need or an opportunity to look at what types of housing units are either allowed or not allowed and find some that might be desirable. So whether you're talking about duplexes, smaller apartments in some cases, or just the classic business on the first floor and some residential uses above. A lot of zoning bylaws don't allow that. Or you have a tiny parcel and the bylaw says you need 10,000 square feet for a unit above, and you just, it doesn't work.
Okay.
Right. And so the overlay concept would allow you to say to people that it would really be compliant here, this area, and then you can tailor it. The overarching goal is that usually there's infrastructure and services rather than creating new sprawling development, you know, in other areas. So we're trying to focus on areas that are already used and developed. The key components of a bylaw would be specialized dimensional requirements. So I wrote setbacks, but it's also the lot size that we talked about. Building and site design criteria. So that helps shape and ensure that you can get what you really want, options for mixed uses. Moderate, you know, residential density is something that we would discuss. And then oftentimes, if there's support, you talk about allowing certain things by right through site plan approval, and what that does is it gives business owners, property owners a little bit more confidence coming forward with a project because they know that it's by right. There's always going to be a place where you draw the line and you want uses to be special permit, and that's fine, but certain uses like hair salons or things that you think are suitable, the idea is to try to get them permitted by right.
That makes sense.
This is just some of
Jeff, just so you know, yes. The building inspector, Bentley Heard is here, so.
Hi, how are you?
That's a lot of his.
Not that. So some of the dimensional criteria, this generally looks at proposed new buildings. So something that we were trying to work out in the bylaw is someone who wants to change a use in an existing building without a lot of changes. So maybe there's a sign change, maybe they need to build a handicap ramp or something. None of this would get triggered. So we want to set it up so if it's just changes in uses, there's a sort of a path for that. And then the next stage is significant alterations to a building, and then there's like, we're going to demolish it and we're going to start over. Right, and so there is some, if you look at that property that we talked about before, that was the
best trip.
Yeah. If something were to get redeveloped in this area, the goal would be to try to require the building to be closer to the road. So the whole concept is buildings go closer to the sidewalks and roads, and the parking goes behind. And that's one of the pedestrian sort of feels too. And that's
what our business district already does that.
It already does that, and so that's super because I think.
Well, except that the businesses want to have it right in front, so everybody likes to drive up and walk out the door. So
right.
It's not pedestrian friendly, but we have that kind of zoning, so that's why we need to get our complete streets and our sidewalks on Route 12 happen.
Okay. Well, that's good to know. I think some communities don't have that, and some people are confused by this. But you can always set it so it could be modified by either a special permit or an approved process. If for some reason it couldn't happen, you're not saying it's been never. Yes, or even planning board in some cases.
Okay.
This is just an image of the classic development pattern of the 50s and 60s with the building way in the back, just a sea of parking and the road. And again, the bottom picture is in Amherst. This building was built in like 2005 and it was brought up to the street.
What is it?
It's offices on the first floor and apartments above.
Okay.
And then right next door is this property that was built in the 50s. And so they're side by side, but they're just so contrasting. Building and site design standards, you could provide the planning board with the ability to review the architecture in some cases for building siting. You'd be having some pedestrian-oriented criteria. You can look, this is where it gets variable in terms of design, but you could look at scale, proportions, height, colors, and things. A lot of people get worried about that, but you can include it. Parking in the rear, shared parking, and signs are important components of all this. This is where we kind of left off with building our model, but what we wanted to do was work with some more towns and then feed more information into the model. But there will be a product at the end of this that will help explain this to members of any town, really. Trying to describe that. Options for mixed use. The bottom picture is a building in Upton that has some attorney's office, and then there's a couple apartments above, and then the building on the right, the building above is a property in East Hampton, which is where I live. It's two small music shops and a tattoo parlor with three apartments above, and it's just the idea of either preserving that kind of use or encouraging. I don't know where this is. What I've been trying to do is pull some images from our region, and I don't have anything against Dunkin' Donuts, but they are developing properties that are single use. You're driving and you're going right there, and it's a sea of parking, and then you drive away and you don't ever do anything else. And so this is where you get the difference between village center style versus a highway business,
urban
or highway business model. So I'm not picking on them, but I think it's just kind of glaring.
Now, is there a difference between Dunkin' Donuts, where you just drive in and you're encouraged to just drive through, and Starbucks, where you're encouraged to get out and enjoy your coffee there, even though it's not that good?
Yes, a lot of towns, not through this process necessarily, but it's the drive through component that you can regulate separately.
That we can use. But we get a Dairy Queen.
Yeah, it's done.
I know. We don't want it to happen again.
Discourage this. There's one of our pictures.
Yeah, you could use one of ours, I'm sure.
Well, it's in an area that is potentially pedestrian-oriented. It's the kind of use that you might want to either prohibit or make it more difficult to do.
Or whatever, make it work. I mean, their problem is that they have like four car lanes before the drive-thru, so everybody hangs out in the street at this.
Is there one in this area here?
No,
it's
just
the up to 8 units per acre that's kind of a holdover. That doesn't really apply necessarily. We would talk about the number of units that would make sense there as we go, but the last thing is options for creating a core district and then a transitional area. Something that we found makes a lot of sense if you're going to have a little bit more intense uses. Usually there's the next pattern is those larger single family houses that.
And when you have the transition areas, is that a transition like right now it's residence but could transition to the other use, or it's between two?
Usually it's residentially oriented, but you could do small businesses. You want to pick the types of uses that you might envision a larger colonial house that can be converted to offices.
Okay.
Or
so it's a transition in use.
It can be used, yes.
Not necessarily transition, whatever, location.
Right. More of use, I think. There's design components, and then there's too much density,
yeah.
You know, can happen. One of the things that I'm trying to figure out, and I think that there's a potential opportunity here, is if you say that there are four units on a small parcel, and you calculate the density per acre, it goes up, it's way high. But there are a lot of examples of small lots with four or five units that works really well, and we're trying to figure out what are the characteristics of that. So I'm trying to build a couple of case studies. The yellow and beige house is four units in Upton, and it's being built as we speak, and it's right in the town center. The picture
all residential?
It's all residential, four units, yeah. The bottom picture is another building in East Hampton, but it's a couple of commercial spaces and four units. And then I was trying to flesh out what those were, but they're examples of those types of uses. This is just an overview of some of our work in Upton. And what I want to show you was this map here. If you look past the red, there's some pink areas on each end, and the pink, solid pink, it was their existing general business district, and then they had that, it's kind of a long residential corridor through the middle. And what we did was we, on the right and left side is the dark red, was the core village center area, which is a little more intense uses, and then the orange, which doesn't show up very good in this slide, but the orange areas were the transitional zones that they decided that nothing more than a duplex would go there to just create the transition from a more dense area to single or two family houses to the single family corridor. And then this is Sutton. We worked in there with them for a little while. Right at the bottom of this image is the town hall in Sutton. Right where the north arrow is the town common. And they created this relatively small overlay district to capture what's called the honeybee building, and then there's an antique shop that is a beautiful historic building that no one could get a new use in because it was residentially zoned, so they couldn't do anything. They couldn't resurrect the antique shop. People had tried to do a little small coffee shop and it wasn't allowed, and so they created this small overlay area. There's a gas station there. So I think I'll just quick go through here because this is where we started to set up how the regulations would work, but what I would like to do is spend more time with your bylaw and work through that. We have some examples of where you bring the building up and the parking goes behind and how the regulations can make that happen. Pedestrian-oriented signs.
Or just kind of a separate thing. Do you have good examples of parking numbers? We've got some parking requirements in town that are 25 years old, and we've had a couple of businesses, actually most every business that comes in who knows what they're doing, like a little business that's done this before in another lot or another place, says that, okay, you require 20 spaces, but we're going to put in 45. Huh. Our zoning is very minimal parking requirements. Is there, so not that I really want to get into the parking stuff, but so we have a good idea when we start looking at these village districts, how much parking would be required.
Right, if you're going to tuck it in back.
Right, and do we need to have two spaces or two and a half spaces for every unit in residential when it's on top of a business?
Right.
That's kind of a big picture.
I think that there are certainly ways to work through that. I don't know enough about your bylaw or the area yet, but I think it can be tailored. And usually some of the key is shared parking. So to make sure that your bylaw allows this building to potentially share that parking right next to it, and just make sure that that's easy enough for a property owner to do.
It's like open half an hour.
questions about what is a village center. And I think that there are examples from West Boston that I think we can pull in. It's really looking at a historic pattern of development and then looking at what happened. So the center of this image is sort of a historic village center pattern where you have the buildings close, the parking's naturally going in alleys to the back, and then at the left side, you can see the two buildings on the far left were probably built in the 50s, and it swapped the location of the buildings to the back and right in the front. So I'm trying to build this anatomy of a village center so to help people figure out what are you aiming to do. And the way we're doing that now is we are working with an aerial photographer who's actually from West Boylston. And one thing that we're doing with this project is, I would say, after we get a little more clarity on this area, we would have him come out and take some aerial photos of this area. Because when you go up and you can see things from the air,
things get clearer.
It does get clearer. And it's a lot easier for other people to understand what's happening. So we're rolling that into the project. This is some shots from Mildred that we did. And then Holden again, we're also going to be working. But when you pull it up, you can see that actually Holden has this stretch that has a lot of...
Oh, in the library. Okay.
Yes, a lot of good characteristics that we want to kind of replicate. And so the aerial photographer is going to really help.
Somehow they hide that much parking. It doesn't look like that much parking for the road.
Yeah, well, you're not there. It's hidden, which is the idea of putting it
right.
I like that in the back.
Yeah.
I think the aerial stuff would be good. Mass DOT also has the aerial photographs.
Oh, they do, yeah, okay.
Which are free.
Can we just get our own drone? Just go do our own thing?
Yes, you could.
Do you have a drone bylaw or
not? Yeah.
The person that we're working with lives in West Boylston. He's been partnering with us.
Is it a drone or an airplane?
It's a drone.
Oh, yeah.
And what he would do is he would contact the police department the day he comes out, but it's been really helpful. It's just something that we're adding.
Well, it's strictly illegal unless he's taking pictures for our department. No.
And then this is Uxbridge. That we have a project in Uxbridge. It's the mill in the back, but it's when you pull up and look from above, it's the mill in the back is so close to this town center area. So talking about a connection there.
Because I think you'll be able to see other things that we can't see when we just walk up.
Yes, and it's important for people who don't or not used to looking at maps or don't understand plans and things. Again, I'm building the anatomy, so I'm trying to help figure out how to explain certain things. So the image on the top is the front and back of the building, and it's on a very small lot. It's 8,700 square feet, but it's got four commercial spaces and four apartments, and it works perfectly in a center area.
So and then, parking on the street?
There's parking in the back.
But not on the street?
And not on the street.
And 8,000 square feet?
Okay. Yes. And then the image that's up in the building, and then there's the site plan. It's also, coincidentally, about 8,700 square feet, but it's just four apartments.
And is there off-street parking or is it?
This one, the parking unfortunately got put in the front of the building, but it's on the property.
Is that the front of the building?
On the left side. It's Main Street. In
the top
corner.
Oh, pictures says left.
So I plan to go back and actually take the picture because I think the building's under construction. We will talk a little bit about design. And so the top left image is a Dunkin' Donuts in Williamsburg, which is by Northampton, where they had some design standards, and you can see the difference that they got out of the franchise.
They really smoked their brand.
We couldn't do that.
And the site plan on the left shows that the parking ended up at the front, but it preserved a lot of the site as not pavement, as opposed to the other image there. So that's the overview that we have. And so I think from here, it's just giving us some time to look through this and then come back with a concept or two.
Yeah, who's our CMRPC person?
All right. I think it's me.
It is you.
Yeah.
It is now. So so you want to contact Mark when you're at the point where you're able to, I'm just going to turn the lights on.
Okay, yes.
But when you're kind of get an idea of stuff, if you want to come and just chat again.
Okay.
Sometimes it's easier to do it instead of pulling together a whole lot of plans.
Yes.
Just scratch
What is your meeting schedule in August? Do you guys go down to one meeting in August?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's later in August.
Later in August.
23rd.
Yeah.
I think it's 23rd.
I was looking for a scrap of paper to give you 20.
Yes, it's 23rd.
Okay. I don't know yet that I'll be ready to come back then, but if not then, definitely in September of one of those meetings.
I have been getting CMRPC emails, so I know you have my email address.
Okay.
But it's Mark, M-A-R-C, dot Frieden, F-R-I-E-D-E-N, at Gmail.
And do I email Melanie too, just to help?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Just so
yeah.
Get lost in the shuffle.
She knows about you already.
I know, no. Infinite.
No. Melanie gets it. We're good.
Are there any other questions or anything that you think?
I think that's covered. I think the expertise, the experience of planning, city planning is—it's still just Little West Boylston, but we do have that little town center, which is really nice and walkable.
I would love to have somehow put a lot of pedestrian requirements in whatever, this bylaw or whatever, if we amend our other bylaws, you know, to make it so that future development goes that way.
And I think what I would do is two things, is whenever I come back, whether it's August 23rd or September, I'll try to lay out a schedule and a phase, like phase one, phase two, to figure out how we can keep it going. And I think what would also be good is making at least being aware of the idea for the complete streets. So oftentimes you lay out the zoning and nothing, it doesn't mean something's gonna happen. It's really just setting up in case someone decides to make a development. But the complete streets will happen, and that
I forget who the complete streets guys are, but they're
same RPC.
But it's your,
so they're probably bringing you to tier two. A lot of towns are going.
I think we have our priorities.
Oh, you're already in the priorities, so you're going
and
into tier three.
Board of Selectmen approved that like 2 months ago or something.
Great.
So we're applying for money.
Yeah. So because oftentimes if you can get the project, a sidewalk or a road project funded, and that goes into play, it actually gets constructed, and then a lot of times that inspires people to look at
notice project. Something happening.
Yes.
Yeah.
So that's a lot of good synergy.
Actually, I can generate for example, you have a picture and you want to change the location of that building, bring it, you know, in front.
Slide it forward.
I can do that.
Okay.
Like for, as I, you know, how much time you have, but I can do that. That would be really encouraging for people to see.
To see
the
difference.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you like this instead of like that?
Yeah.
I think before the end of December, I think if we could pick a parcel or two that you think either you, whether we would contact the owner and work with them a little bit, but to do a rendering, that is definitely something that we could do.
Right.
Yeah, I think that can be very helpful.
I mean, we should think about some of the lots that.
Would we want to do? Would we want to show something that's successful and why it's successful, or do we want to pick something that's
unoccupied
and then?
Yeah.
Well, I think if it's empty and unoccupied, we already got the before part.
Right.
Let's go work.
No, and then we'll move, like you said, we'll move the facade forward and put some.
Yeah.
Show where the parking would be or something.
Good. Great. All right. Well, thank you.
Yes, thank you for coming.
Yes. Thank you. I'm going to take a minute to back on the
sidewalk.
Yeah,
thank you.
I think we have public hearing continue. Oh, that's easy.
Yeah.
No. Public hearing was continued until tonight. I guess it was at 7:48. We'll open the public hearing for site plan review for the expansion of the parking lot and stormwater upgrades at 307 Lancaster Street, the Bethlehem Bible Church.
Are they here?
On Route 110. They're not here, we got a letter. Would you like to read a letter?
To myself or to everybody?
To everybody.
Let's see. Dear West Boylston Planning Board, Goddard Consulting, on behalf of applicant Bethlehem Bible Church, we request that the public hearing scheduled for July 12th be continued to August 23rd for the site plan review for the parcel known as 307 Lancaster Street, map 127, parcel 11 in West Boylston, Mass. This request is to allow for plan revisions that have been requested by the planning board's peer reviewer. As the continuation is due to delays by the applicant, the The applicant is willing to grant a 90-day extension to the original 90-day period that the planning board has given to render the review and decision of the project. It does.
So, yes, so they had something, right, we have 90 days to act on.
Yep.
So he's extending that, so it should be okay.
So do you want a motion to do that, or just?
Yep, is there any other discussion? Or is maybe make a motion to continue to?
A motion to continue the Bethlehem Bible Church project to August 23rd, as requested in the letter.
At what time do we have times? Are they the only ones there? 7 o'clock, yeah, so the motion is to be 7 o'clock on the.
So they call on August 23rd.
Please state the time.
August 23rd, 7 o'clock, I second it.
Any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. In that meeting, the proposal can change, they change.
Okay, excellent. All right. Cheryl Tony Home?
Is this done?
Actually, we had a couple of people in here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mark, you want to grab whoever's up here, I think that's.
Which one's 137?
I think it is 137.
I want to just get the people up so they don't have to stay around.
Oh, great.
Hi.
Hi.
Good.
Oh, great.
I don't think you're up yet, all right?
You're up?
Yeah.
Yep.
You're up.
We're kids, we got work to do, we get it done.
I think that was on the order.
It is, you are, you're a little. We're done with the public hearing, so we can take anything else that's here we can take. We're here.
You guys sign in for the audio, please.
I didn't know people were gonna be here, I would have sat next to them. I'm sitting here so I can get out.
I thought you were doing your work on your.
I was.
I thought you were like where you were born.
I didn't want to sit next to them.
Oh, that's it. All right, so we're here now with 137-1-151 Shrewsbury Street, site plan review. Was, the hearing was closed and I think it was approved at the last meeting, but we have to review the letter and vote to sign the approval letter and plans. And we got a little update.
We do, yes. For the record, I'm Patrick McCarty. My company's McCarty Engineering out of Leominster. And I'm covering for Brian, who you all met. As we were double booked this evening, so Brian has been diligently working back and forth with Griffin at VHB to make sure that all of the I's were dotted and the T's were crossed, and I believe VHB sent you a letter today.
We got an email saying
they were happy with the plans, and so we brought you a few sets of the plans this evening that are the latest and greatest that VHB has signed off on, and then Pignelli also sent us an email with a couple questions that I believe everything's been addressed except for the parking agreement.
Yes.
Mr. Fuller has requested his attorney to draft that agreement. Unfortunately, we don't have that for this evening, and we're hopeful that that could be a condition of site plan approval, that we get that to you prior to occupancy certificate being issued. We're going to get it to you a lot sooner than that, but that would be a good.
Is it possible? Well, I'm just thinking that we can sign, if the board wants, we could sign it, approve it, send it over to the town clerk and just hold the copy that goes to you so the time can start and then your lawyers can get the paperwork.
By the time we get them today, it'll just be late.
Yeah.
I'm not actually going to, we're closing on that property in 60 days. Well, I'm actually going to own it, but right now, technically, Mike's the guy who bought it. We're buying the money. Yeah, he still owns it, so we have to go. It is a journey that's kind of slowed down.
So we can sign, do all the approvals, and then we just
what is the
parking
on the
new shared, it's shared parking.
Shared parking
is allowed as long as there is an agreement between the two owners.
Okay.
Right now, he is the two owners, so he usually agrees. But if he sells, but if he sells one lot, we want to have that in place so it goes with the deed.
And then you were just talking about the property way to the left, I guess?
Mm-hmm.
And does that have anything to do with this?
Nope.
Okay.
No, it's just the way I purchased the property, for some reason the seller wanted to do one lot every 9 months for some reason. So I bought the first lot. Now the second lot's closing in 60 days and the third lot will close next March. So basically I'm going to have a piece of paper.
That's known as the Uncle Sam acquisition process.
That's exactly.
Oh, it happens on tax reason.
That's a technical term for it.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. Does anyone have any other questions?
No, no, I'm good.
Did you get a chance to review the amended certificate of site plan review approval that was sent around? Wanted to do this?
Well, they all
have
a copy.
I trust you.
They all have a copy.
Yeah, we have a good copy.
Second. Nice.
That's it. You sit in the big seat there. And we can start signing these.
Yeah, there's five copies here.
Or do we want our... yeah, no, we need to sign
the Sharpie.
Is it, no, they're all
paper. It's paper, right?
Yeah.
Sorry. How are we doing this?
That's why I just say you.
We say that all the time.
The trouble is when they staple the gap. Otherwise, it's probably
yeah.
The original.
Okay.
It's not trouble.
You need the
yeah.
Other. I was just telling you that I got the name was.
No. Okay. It's a new one. All right. Let's see which one. Now it's completely
do that. It would
just
right.
That's just a.
You want to listen to it, right?
Yeah. It'd be funny if we looked at the like the next copy and they weren't only run and then it's probably just better.
That was so
good.
It's a violin. I can't get back.
I
All right.
I moved.
Thank you very much.
All right, I think next one was Cheryl Tamiola, is that? You.
I just pulled it up.
That's good. We got your correspondence. That's good.
What did you think?
Well, actually, Bentley, you wanna come up? We're talking about potential zoning changes for parking of commercial vehicles to reduce from 18,000 pounds to 10,000 pounds?
Well, the amount of pounds is something that we hope that you could work with us, all work together to determine what exactly would be the best one. I mean, some towns have 10,000, some have 14, your town has 18.
We brought some examples to show.
You did, okay.
And also, the description of gross vehicle weight, commercial vehicle, these are all things that should probably be inserted into a new bylaw. You know, description of commercial vehicle, what a commercial vehicle weight is, you know, because there's all different kinds of weights, curb weight. It all gets a little confusing, but
so we have the town of Holden.
Yep.
And
yes.
I have made these copies of different vehicle weights showing the weights of different size trucks.
Okay, perfect. Okay, that's great.
And there's some pictures so you guys can.
Do we have a couple extra?
Give us my ideas.
Do we have a couple extra? I thought I saw a bunch. Are there a couple
yeah,
more?
Yeah.
No, for the.
Nothing, we only have one copy of.
No, for.
Yes. I'll give them a copy. I have a copy for them too.
Okay, okay, fantastic.
I've just made these in your consideration. For
yeah, this is great, because that was our big question. Was
we were thinking that
I don't know,
the truck that they were returning well, might already be over 18,000 pounds.
Right.
I mean, it was a tractor,
that's
a tractor.
That's the whole idea. It's the last page, actually.
Yes,
you're lucky.
Yeah. The bottom of the last page, right?
Yes. Right. So we were thinking that even at 18,000 pounds, it was already a
in violation.
A violation.
Going to court and
yeah.
Right, so. So you're well aware of what's been going on.
It is a tractor. It's a tractor from a tractor trailer.
It's a
man
tractor truck. A big, huge.
Okay, so I brought along a couple pictures because we're dealing with this right now. And if you all want to look at it, this is it parked right next to our fence.
Oh, yeah. So
and you can see that's a 6-foot fence and a 12-foot high tractor.
And what's your address? Where do you live?
40 Maplewood Ave.
Maplewood?
This is right. The town of Shrewsbury. And they, in the town of Worcester, I don't think they have a definition in the bylaw for the gross vehicle weight definition. So they have it, I like that they have that in their bylaw, the town of Shrewsbury. And they went with 14,000 pounds.
14,000.
Yes. Now, gross vehicle weight, meaning truck loaded.
Right.
Okay, but
regardless
see,
of whether it's loaded or not, that's the gross vehicle weight.
Yes, yes, true, but in fact.
Okay, but Bentley, maybe you want
to. Well, I feel this truck that we're discussing here, it's a tractor to a semi, it's a semi truck tractor. And the other party, who's not here, brought it up situation, saying you just got the truck reweighed, and the truck weighs 17,800 pounds.
Yeah, the truck. So the truck. Steel that's there.
Right. However, I don't know who witnessed this. For example, I'm not trying to be a devil's advocate, but the truck with 10 wheels on it and the fifth wheel, the receiving wheel, that if parts of those were removed when it was weighed, it could weigh substantially less.
Well, 17,000 sounds like it would be just the tractor, not the trailer, because tractor
is... Right, yes, it is. This is just the tractor weighs it in at 17,000. So it's great because it says gross vehicle weight, the 18,000 gross vehicle
that's
weight.
That's on your bylaw says gross.
Gross vehicle weight.
Yeah, so he can't have his truck gross vehicle weighted at 17,000 pounds and weigh 17,000 pounds, or else he can only drive around in his truck. He couldn't put anything in it.
Well, it's he calls a trailer.
That's what I mean. He's got to be able to add the weight of the trailer to get
those gross vehicle weight. Well, out there. His vehicle's out there, and it's 17,000, let's assume it's correct.
17,000.
And even if it's off by 10% or so, or 20%, it's still going to be less than 28,000. But the thing that I'm seeing is what Bentley gave us is these extra heavy truck tractors.
Yeah.
It changes the wording from gross vehicle weight to gross carrying weight, I think is what it is.
Yes.
So that changes the definition, but that's not in our bylaw.
So my understanding is that he's parking only this thing.
Yes.
So, and though the container never comes in. So that's right. Their argument, right?
Yes. Well, the tractor itself is in
18.
In his original illustration showed it as over 18,000. And then he just had it reweighed, he said. And that was.
It's under 18.
It's under 18 now. That's.
But I don't think that. I mean, personally.
Well, can I just interject something right now? Is if the if he went with the tanks empty of fuel, then that would account for 600 pounds.
But I'm really talking more of a general thing, not about a specific person. We're just saying the weight's too high. You know, we're looking at other towns, and it's, you know, how close to the house is where we are. There's children, we're in a residential area, and it's just too high. It's a huge truck.
You know, the roadway is 20 feet wide, and there's not enough room for two vehicles to go by when the tractor drives up the hill.
Does he come in once and leave once each day?
He leaves at 5:30, early, very early in the morning, wakes us up.
Okay.
Very loud, vibrating.
Well, if you read what some of the things that we've mentioned, was diesel fumes, the noise, the air brakes are startling, the engine is loud, it causes vibration. It's unusual. If you look at the picture, it's a very densely populated area, and you can see that he parks the truck right next to our fence.
So the exhaust is facing?
And so...
it's not many feet. How far is... how many feet from
okay,
the
fence?
So I think 20 feet from our house. What we're looking for is to potentially change the zoning bylaw.
Right.
It seems like that's something... Would that help you if we change the bylaw to something lesser? When does it get to a point where it creates a problem with someone with a big pickup truck or that kind of situation?
I don't believe it would. Even, you know, on the page I gave you, a medium-sized truck, you know, for example, this is a good, this picture shows, I would say, a dual rear wheel. It's like a one-ton dump truck. That's still, you know,
it's still
5,000 to 6,000 pounds. It's not in the 18,000 pound range.
So if we said 10,000 and then be able to say that it's the same, it's in Shrewsbury, it's 10,000.
It's 14,000 in Shrewsbury, it's 10,000 in Holden. But then we went to Ford, went to the manufacturer site, and they use the term gross vehicle weight rating.
so what she's trying to say is.
Well, it's 450.
It says the gross vehicle weight rating is 14,000. And then what's.
That means truck loaded.
Loaded with a trailer or whatever.
No, not with a trailer. No, no, he's not with a trailer. This is loaded on the truck.
And what is this?
Okay, and so each one of they show wheelbases, so it starts to get confusing, length of trucks and how much that they'll carry. Okay.
So are the other towns you looked at, they're defining certain terms and they're limiting it by gross weight.
That's
only weight. So they haven't specified the type of truck or
no. No, they specified more.
One weight. Other thing, you know, we need to consider is, you know, our town is the right to farm community. So we have to compare those kind of communities.
I think farm equipment is excluded.
Yes.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
But it's a commercially licensed vehicle.
I would think that would be better to put into the bylaws.
That is in the bylaws.
It's actually very commercial.
Mm-hmm.
I think the bylaw so we just need to amend the bylaw to either define gross vehicle weight as being gross vehicle weight and gross carrying weights, or reduce it from 18,000 to 10 or 14, some number.
I read it last time. It's no commercially licensed vehicle in excess of 18,000 pounds gross vehicle weight, except school buses or farm vehicle. And construction equipment during actual construction on the site shall be parked overnight in a residential district.
We've got the definition of the commercial vehicle, but not gross vehicle weight.
Right.
Shrewsbury has the definition of gross vehicle weight.
Yep. So that's
it's
getting
even. It's more specific.
Right. I believe that should be added to.
Right.
Well, yep.
And that makes
sense.
You need
to
define your terms you're going to use.
Right.
Right, well, that's kind of like gross vehicle weight is a common term, but it gets down to the legal.
But there's no way that you could say that a tractor, which requires the highest level of a commercial driver's license because it's the highest rated vehicle to drive. I mean, the gross vehicle weight of an average tractor trailer is 80,000 pounds, which is the weight of the tractor, the weight of the trailer, and the weight of the stuff.
Gross carrying weight.
Well, GV, gross vehicle weighted rate, I think. Because it's the weight that the wheels and the axles can carry, and they consider that for bridges and the road it's going over, so they call it the gross vehicle weight. And there's no way that you can say a tractor for anything is less than 18,000 pounds. I mean, there's no, you wouldn't make a tractor to tow something less than 18,000 pounds. Because
it sounds good, it'll
be like a golf cart.
It's going to court,
you know?
So that question, is that going to be decided by the court, or?
The court had already made a decision that he was not to have that truck in the neighborhood, parked in a residential neighborhood overnight, and he has appealed to the court's decision. We were supposed
the court or your decision? The court has appealed to court decision?
He's appealed to court decision.
No, he missed the appeal. He missed his right to appeal, the 30-day appeal.
The initial, yes.
So the judge ordered on that.
Okay.
Yes, in other words.
Well, let's hold on.
That was the problem. He didn't.
Just hold on.
Yeah, he had 30 days initially to appeal the decision, which he didn't. And that's what the judge ruled on, was that he didn't.
Didn't appeal your decision.
Right.
Okay.
In time. So now he's appealing her decision, the judge's decision.
Okay, so.
But this whole time he's still parked there.
He's still parked there.
Cease and desist.
Yeah.
And he had
30 days
to appeal it. He didn't.
Right.
Bentley had sent him tickets.
Yeah.
Right, Bentley?
Yes. Well.
And Bentley went to a hearing for those tickets. He did appeal that in the housing court. And what happened there, Bentley?
Actually, we lost.
And why was that?
I think
he gave a different weight, or what did he? That was the very first hearing.
The very first hearing.
Yeah. That was the tickets.
Yeah, he appealed.
For being overweight and the business issue?
Yes, because I wrote him for having a business and no home occupation permit, and the truck being overweight, two things. actually, you're right, because he had a copy of a registration saying the truck was underweight.
So it was in that area, but that was the weight of the truck, not the gross vehicle.
The gross weight. Yes, the weight of the truck.
Yeah.
Not including the load or anything, just the weight of the tractor itself.
But the regulation says gross vehicle weight, so why wouldn't the judge interpret gross vehicle weight? Like, I thought on the registration for a vehicle, you have gross vehicle weight, and it says right there. Not, you take it down to Pandoff's pit and weigh the truck and get a slip that weighs this much. Gross vehicle weight is a definition.
The judge accepted that.
Weight.
Is accepting that. And the judge was finding that hearing, the weight and the business to be acceptable. He didn't have a business, so
but
the judge is saying.
He never carries a load in there, but it's just a trap. It's just a cab.
Just a trap,
yeah. So that's under the 18,000.
Well,
that's where,
but it's a character, it's the bylaws trying to set a characteristic of the truck, not how much weight somebody can park in that driveway. I hope.
No, he's using how much weight he can park, because that's why he has the truck weighed again.
Right. But that's why the intent was to write it as gross vehicle weight, so that
it characterizes the vehicle.
It's something capable of carrying a huge load.
Yes.
It's not going to park there, even though the thing itself is.
Right, even though he doesn't bring the load and park in his driveway, he's got a vehicle. It'd be like saying, you have a vehicle that's, capable of going 180 miles an hour, but you're not always going at 180 miles an hour. I think we were trying to characterize the vehicle, not limit the amount of weight he could put in his driveway.
And so the other towns doing that? You mentioned Holden and Shrewsbury. Well, they've used a lower truck weight to...
And you said they defined the gross vehicle weight, though, in their bylaw?
Yes. Yes. I think Shrewsbury does. Shrewsbury? Yeah.
Yes.
Because we're not having a hearing on whether we're just discussing if we should have
voted in the meeting. Yeah.
Right.
The actual facts of the matter.
I'm just wondering if we monkey around with the weight, somebody's going to come back in with I don't know what they're going to do with their weight, or it's going to go the other way, and somebody's going to have a big truck and it's going to go over
there.
We don't want to do this twice.
Personal truck.
Right. So that when we wrote the original bylaw at the town meeting, when they were discussing it, there was a question of because I didn't know it, and many people at town meeting didn't know what 18,000 gross vehicle weight was, and people suggested that as the number. We probably should go back. I'm not sure how detailed the minutes are at the town meeting for it, but the idea was that it was going to address just this kind of a vehicle, but what the intent is and what actually gets written
and
decided by the judge is a whole different story. So maybe we need to be ready at the next town meeting when we present this, if we do a zoning bylaw change, to put it to either 10 or 14,000. That's what it seems like. We're going to have to hold a public hearing as a planning board, advertise it,
right.
Post everything, and then make a presentation at town meeting. But I would like to have a lot of support on it, like from Bentley, especially. If you say I don't need to change it, and we stand up and say it should be, and then they say, well, what does the building inspector think? And you say the opposite, and it doesn't pass. So it's more, having this is a great thing, because this is what we would like to have at the last town meeting. So it will define what is the size.
I mean, DOT goes into this in no lack of depth when they talk about vehicle licensing, the weight of the vehicle, the type of vehicle, the length, like all this kind of stuff. I mean, the DOT could give us a definition.
Right, but is there some, can we get that research done?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's like class one vehicle. Class one vehicle.
Maybe there's another way of describing it.
Describing that vehicle.
Just the weight.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, and then it's a commercially
class
licensed operator. It goes over this weight. I mean, I guess I don't care if we put in the weight. I just don't want to sort of monkey around with the weight and then not solve the problem.
Right.
You know, if somebody else comes in and says, I have a slightly lighter truck, But it's still a commercial vehicle.
Well, this is pretty huge.
Yeah, well, this is nice, this is clear.
You know, I wanna make sure, I just wanna make sure this solves the problem.
I'll say, you know, building inspector has connection with the other building inspector, right?
Yes.
Maybe you can talk to them and find out. Similar, like our town, what do they have? What kind of bylaw?
Yeah, look into zoning it.
Yeah, zoning. So with that, you know, you may have some idea. So is it 14 or 18 or 10 or whatever?
Now, I've worked in a couple of other towns before and this has never come up before.
Yeah, but you know.
I understand, I'm not saying it's a rare case that would come up at all, but.
Yes.
It is absolutely addressed.
Now there is an issue, what do we do?
Right.
Okay, I can do that. Can we do that for next meeting, which is August 23rd? Because if we're gonna be, we're gonna have to post a public hearing in the first meeting in September.
Can I just say a couple more things about the weight of these trucks? And so Cheryl, in that, where, this one here. It says, and I only used four because it's something that we all might understand easily. And so they, the Ford pickup trucks are F-150, okay? F-250, F-350, F-450. Now, the F-350 has a 9,900 pound on one type of axle, right? Gross vehicle weight rating. Now, that same F-350 can have a 14,000 pound gross vehicle weight rating, depending on the length of the truck and so, and how much the Ford says you can put in the truck safely. All right? And so I started out thinking 10,000. And maybe 20 years ago, 10,000 was a good number. But the way trucks are nowadays, I'm thinking, because don't forget, there's still a lot of small contractors probably that are in your town. And so if you put it at 10,000, then you're gonna push a lot of people out of it. So we're trying to get the in-between here. And that's why I felt like Shrewsbury's 14,000 pound was a really good number. Because it keeps out the big trucks, but doesn't really hurt the little guy. And that's really what we're trying to do here. You know, the small contractor, we're not feeling it. No one's saying anything about that. But it's these big trucks that are, like I said, these are small neighborhoods with small roads. And so, you know, you add children to that and.
And it's all, it's location as always.
And the fields.
If you were out somewhere up on 110 with 3 acres in a lot, no one's gonna worry about it. But if it's in the zoning, that's what we wanna be able to give enforcement if we have to.
Yeah.
The Mass Iowa is 5 minutes.
5 minutes, yeah.
Okay, but then.
Yeah, but this is a normal truck.
Our neighbor was saying that he's repairing it. So the Iowa means you can repair it. Unless you can idle it longer if you're repairing your truck or whatever. But, you know, there's children.
Right, but if you're just saying you're repairing it is one thing. If he's really repairing it, then.
He's not doing it at 5:30 in the morning.
Well, yeah, I don't want to get into that.
Let's not get into it.
We know, but I'm just saying at schools, they're only allowed to idle school buses 5 minutes. Because of children, that's a big thing that they passed for kids, which we didn't know years ago. You know, that was so bad for us. So, I mean, it's in a neighborhood with kids. And he's repairing it and running it an hour, half hour.
Actually, if you wanted to expand your scope here, that could be like a Board of Health thing. You know, I mean.
Noise ordinance or?
It was already.
Yeah, no, my sound.
It was deemed a nuisance.
It's a nuisance.
Okay, good.
It was deemed a nuisance by Mr. Legere.
Nobody goes to.
Board of Health, Mr. Legere. Deemed a nuisance.
They.
Oh, right.
It's very hard to.
So then what happened? It was deemed a nuisance.
Yeah, that's the thing.
I live next to a gun range, it does not matter.
I know, I do all the time.
I know.
I know.
I mean, I was thinking if we wanted to put characteristics in there that would be a little bit more substantive.
Bentley's going to do a little research, and I mean, if it's just changing it to 14,000, yeah, the definition of gross vehicle weight, that might be the easiest and quickest.
And then I would suggest, like, if it's a vehicle that requires a commercial driver's license, I mean, that might be
too. No, because it's all different classes.
Yeah, I mean, all of us, I assume everyone here is a class 3, could drive up to 26,000 pounds. So
you're not that numbered anymore. It's A, B, C, and D.
No, right. But I mean, like, the lowest class can drive a 26,000 pound vehicle. I mean, that's the way that's the minimum.
I don't know what the numbers are.
Yours is 28,000, right?
26. What?
That's right. I think, yeah.
Oh, my God.
I think we have a direction here, and I think we know where we're going.
Yeah.
And we're going to have more discussions on the 23rd. Hopefully we'll be able to draft something and post it for a public hearing in September, because I think the town meeting's in October.
Is it?
We have to send it to the selectmen and then get it back from the selectmen.
Is it the second Tuesday of the month?
It's the 23rd.
It's the 23rd.
Oh, it is?
We moved it this for August.
Oh, okay. I see. All right.
So we're going to have to look at how to post and make sure we get all that stuff
done. Get the time. And what do the Board of Selectmen,
Board of Selectmen has to refer it back to us.
Can you help that?
I think that'll be fine. We just need to get it down on the 23rd so that the timing works.
So we have to come back, or?
No, you don't have to.
No,
you can watch
we'll
it on
we'll
TV.
Take it,
or,
and so there's nothing else that we need to do?
Keep an eye on us, make sure
keep an eye
if
sure
you see anything that doesn't work or
not
right, let us know. We're going to have a public hearing in September.
To change the
problem,
you have to do
a public hearing
procedure.
I thought there was a town meeting after.
Right, that's what we want to bring
it
to.
So we have the warrants in September, and then it goes,
so we have to have a public hearing in order to do that.
We have a public hearing to review the language with anybody that wants to contribute. And then that language is what goes to public.
Because if we have discussions that should have occurred at the public hearing, at town meeting, people in the town meeting will say, well, this isn't prepared well enough, it's wrong, we're just going to do the terms, it won't happen. So at the public hearing is when we want to raise any issues that if we miss something or if we made it too stringent, we expect to hear.
Right, that's what other people will discuss, 14,000 pounds, 15,000 pounds, 30,000 pounds. You know, I mean, that's when anybody else who's paying attention will come in and talk about that stuff.
Anyone who's invested.
Yeah, we should probably talk to the local mechanics and see what their thoughts are. I mean, they
and other
know
people.
I mean, so you know, like,
I mean, there's other contractors in town too, but
their
vehicles.
Right, but talk it up with people that you know, so you can find out.
He gets all the contractors.
As a matter of fact, if you look on page 2 of this, there's a pre-work truck.
Oh yeah.
You know, years ago, my previous life, I was a contractor too, and I had a truck similar to this. I just parked my driveway.
Well, that's the 10 to 20,000 range.
Yes.
That's
it was quite probably that big. It was a van cab with a box. It was a box truck. And
so more like this one, this furniture truck.
Oh,
that's
great.
No, it was more like the one on top.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the box truck.
It wasn't a heavy truck, it was just a van a van with a 1-ton chassis and a box on it.
Okay.
Just regular box truck. Something like that. I think that would be okay in the neighborhood.
One of the things I was going to say was that might distinguish is the elevated exhaust. Like if you have a down exhaust or an elevated exhaust.
No, that can change on trucks.
Well, I know it can change, but you probably wouldn't want the elevated exhaust, especially in this considering. You know?
There's too many variables in that,
right?
Okay.
Yeah, I would want to consider that. Because the little kids are down in the low area. You put it up there, it's more dispersion, but
it's also right in your window.
Yeah.
Ground, at least it blows wet.
But, so we'll get more background information and try to move this through the town meeting.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks for the research.
You
remember the helps.
All right.
Do you need any of this stuff?
I don't
think there's
a discussion
on
how
we should address the
ordinances.
Yes. Thank you
again. Thank you. Site plan review process and coordination.
That's right.
Oh boy. I used to be able to sneak in. Site plan reviews that are not completed, and the only way to get them completed is through zoning enforcement.
Yep.
And you are our zoning enforcement because we can jump up and down and shake our hands and nothing happens. It's you and the occupancy permit that really controls things being finished and completed adequately. So I guess the intent would be to try to coordinate a little bit better. You've got my phone number. If there's any questions, you can just call, come to the meetings, send an email to the West Coast, West Coast and Planning Board. I think you're too much talking.
You want water?
Yeah. No, thanks. Yeah. But generally, just trying to get things done, because I think I just off the top of my head, I was thinking of some sites, and we've got somewhere around 7 or 8 of them anyway, that
we just got. Frozone.
Frozone, yeah. Well, the point on that one is that we haven't had VHB do a review of it. In our minutes, we've asked them in the past about drainage, submitting some support, supporting information that the drainage is in compliance with the design. Mm-hmm. They didn't give us that.
Yeah, I didn't even look at it. Just
yeah, no, and that's the issue, is that they'll give us a little bit here, and then 6 months later, we'll get a little something else, but if we hold an occupancy permit, or just issue an occupancy permit for 30 days, and it forces them to get stuff done, that really helps us to close out our files.
That's what I've done on Frozen My Back.
Is it?
Yeah.
Okay.
They're on a temporary
good
CO because I was waiting for this information right there.
Okay. Well, this in our minutes, and we've sent stuff over to you in the past, it's not just the as-built and the certification, because the certification doesn't really say that the differences between what was approved and what was built. If you read the certifications, this is what we did, and there was something going on in the back parking area, but then they talk about the rain gardens. If they show you the design for the rain gardens, which is it's the history on this, the rain gardens show that they go from the surface of the pavement down. It doesn't go up. It shows a depression. If you go out there now, the pictures that I have shown have it going up. So they need to excavate that whole area out and build it the way they said they were going to build it, or show us that they have some drainage calculations that prove that they don't have to. I'm fine with we made this other thing twice as big so we don't need it here. Mm-hmm. But what's been approved is a depression, as far as I remember. But that was done in 2009, I think, or 2012. I mean, it was a long time ago. And during the last site plan application, when they did an amended site plan, they didn't submit any drainage calculations for changes. Mm-hmm. So I'm assuming that they're still going by what they did previously. If they do want to make drainage changes, then we'll send it to VHB and have them review it. And then if everything's fine, then let's go ahead, because I mean, it looks great. The building looks good. The activity in there is going great. He's doing some advertising on some of the local stations and doing a lot of good things. So that's great. The only issues I really have is that he's not in compliance with zoning through the permit process. And then he changed some of his sidewalk stuff. I actually saw someone walking out as I was coming out of the Planet Fitness for a change on those stones. A kid was walking on the stones to stay out of the road, and he actually fell. And he went into the road on those. He's got these big 6 to 8 inch stones, which were not on the approved plan, which, as far as I'm concerned, should get all taken out and make it grass. I mean, that's a danger right next to the edge of the road. He couldn't put a sidewalk in, is what he told us, but he threw in a bunch of rocks. So pull the rocks out, put a sidewalk, but make it grass, but make it safe so no one gets hurt.
Is that his guardrail there?
No, well, the other thing I had for him was the question of is the guardrail even safe anymore because it's half buried. He's got to raise it back up because I'm pretty sure they have to be 30 inches off the existing grade. And right now it's buried down, so it's a safety hazard. But that's all stuff VHB is going to pick up if they ever get a chance to go out and do the final review. So that's all the things, but right now if a car goes in there, as far as I can see, the car is going to go over the guardrail and right through his window. And nobody wants that. Mm-hmm. And so the guardrail's not doing anything at all. People walking, it's a danger. He paved that second driveway access, and then he just
blocked it off.
He put a little bump.
He blocked it for
so
that block, but now it's not there.
It's not blocked at all. So there's that. And then he said in his note something about two additional parking spaces. And I'm not sure where those were. And
this is two additional parking spaces painted near the new retail building.
Right, but how could you do that? It's not on the site plan review. The site plan application squeezed
the dumpster spaces. Did he squeeze the dumpster spot out or something?
I'm not sure if he made the spot. He may have made the spaces 6 feet wide or some more narrow.
But I thought there was a dumpster area. Maybe we didn't put that in.
I mean, it's all possible, and it all could be done. Could be having been done correctly, but we don't know because he's just doing it and not coming back to us.
It appears to be a little different than the original proposed.
Right.
However, that is.
Right.
Now you're bringing out those rocks. They look very dangerous.
So I mean, those are a whole list of things. But I think now that we have the as-built and the certification, we'll send it off to VHB. We should do that and then send it off and have them come up and do an inspection and kind of follow up with a list of things that are needed.
We have an as-built?
Yes, it's a good one.
Oh,
okay. We
picked up the season. That's just how fresh it is. I just
the Easter on it.
Did we get I thought we got a copy. I thought I saw one in an email.
Yeah, I got an email copy earlier this week, but
right.
It was so large I couldn't even.
So small.
It wouldn't come up on my computer.
Oh, the size, okay, yeah.
And if I did, it would have been on this size, which wouldn't do
anything. Yeah, it doesn't help. No.
So I was waiting for the large copy.
Right, so that makes sense. So I guess maybe they'll contact VHB and ask them to go out and do an inspection. I guess those are the big picture issues that I have. Do you want to go through each site and if you have questions with each site, what your concerns are, or if you want to just leave it at these are the issues and we're going to try to work?
Yeah,
I can get
a copy of that.
Okay. What do people think about the document, this draft?
The other thing is in the agenda. Before the building inspector issues the occupancy, maybe just send us an email. Hey, planning board is okay. So that way, if there is an issue, we will say that the planning board will address. Okay. Right?
Well, so the way it is now, it says I can give them up to a 1 year temp CO.
Agreed, but at the same time, you could check in with the planning board too, right?
I could, yes. Yeah.
So this won't happen.
Okay.
Well, I think in the zoning bylaws, you're required to issue a certificate of completion on the projects, on the site plan. The building inspectors in the past, they said, you guys are doing all the site plan stuff. I don't really want to have to try to figure out what was supposed to be done. Are you guys happy with it? They were accepting of us writing a certificate of completion and then submitting it to you, and then or submitting it to them, and then they would move forward with the occupancy. So that was one way for us to try to keep it in line and have something to talk about. But in the bylaw, it says that it has to be done before an occupancy is issued. But it also, I just sitting in your seat, if I were doing it, I'm not going to write a certificate of completion. planning board has VHB who puts out there, we've got an engineer certified as-built, we can look at all that stuff and say it's certified as being complete. But our bylaws written, it says it's issued by the building inspector. So that might be something else we can change, but let's see how it all kind of goes.
Yes, yes.
I think it's just supposed to be a system of checks and balances, but we just have to figure out a communication way in order to check and balance one another, that's all.
Makes sense.
Not so when they get the license, you know, occupancy permit, they have no interest in doing all those things.
Well, that's true.
So keep postponing, keep postponing, keep postponing.
Well, that's one, of the ones that I brought up was the Flag RV. They came in a year ago, or a little over a year ago, talking about an existing building that they were going to just rip down and rebuild in the same footprint, and then got doubled in size.
So, on that one, because on the second review portion here says, expansion shall include floor space increase of 5,000 square feet. From the old building to the new building was not a difference of 5,000 square feet. And the floor space was not over 25% increase. So I didn't, that was my bad. I didn't send them for site plan review because.
Right, but it doesn't stop. They still need a site plan review right now. Because they whether they did it or are going to do it, they are in violation of zoning until they get site plan review.
Well, I told them it wasn't, I didn't think it was required because of the expansion was less than 5,000 square feet and less than 25%, I didn't feel it needed to come for site plan.
Oh, if it is then it's fine. But I thought it was, when I looked at the aerial photographs, I looked at what the building was, and I looked at what the new building is, and it's more than double the size.
Yep. Actually, I don't have the numbers on head, in my head, but it was not an increase of more than 5,000 square feet or 25% compared to what it was. So
I'm saying it was still.
But it's, when you look at the photograph,
even if it was double, it wasn't a 5,000 square foot increase.
It's whichever is less.
It says, or a space increase of 25% or more within a 10-year period.
And then
either of them,
whichever is less, is the last phrase there.
Right.
If it's less.
I would have to double check my numbers, but I didn't feel it was 25% either.
Right. Well, but that's why it would be good to coordinate. That's what we need to do. Because I went to Google, I looked at the old, whatever it was, 2009 version, is nice aerial photograph, and then I did the 2016, and there's another aerial photograph, and it's pretty clear.
Well, again, that was my bad, because I didn't realize I had to go for a site plan. I'll send you guys every commercial permit I get if you want. It's fine with me.
Well, I mean, if it's close, I'm fine with you sending it to me. Oh, well, I don't need the whole permit. I just call and say, okay, this guy wants to do a roof. Okay, let him go. This guy wants to expand his building. Okay, well, how big and where? Mm-hmm. I'd rather have the coordination going. And then once you get tired of me saying the same old thing that you know I'm going to say, then you don't need to call me.
Yeah, but I must say this is a unique thing to this town.
Yes,
you know, I haven't encountered this in the other towns I've worked in that.
Do they have site plan reviews?
Yes, but it was usually triggered by, you know, more. Because technically, the way this is written, new construction or exterior expansion of any non-residential building.
Any new construction.
That means everything, every permit would have to come to you guys.
Any non-residential?
Any commercial permit.
Yes.
Every one would have to come to
any
you.
Any new one. Yep.
And okay, you got
well,
it.
Well, no, but that's
what you asked for.
Well, but the thing that's happened is that we've run into problems where there's been a couple of sites where they get the building permit, they do the work, and then they have three little parking spaces, and then they have to expand, and the neighbors get all upset because how come they're putting in like a, it always comes out to 14 parking spaces because it gets below 50, mm-hmm. and 14 spaces right next to someone who's living in a residence, and then we get a couple of phone calls. I mean, I'm sure you get a whole bunch of them too, but.
And yeah. Mike is also on temp CO also.
Really? That long?
Okay. Yes.
All right. Well, yeah, because, I mean, how is the ideas of like drainage and parking and the whole deal? I'm not sure.
That's been approved by the Conservation Commission already.
Right, but site plan review is different than conservation. They're parallel, of course.
What do they get? What are you saying to them?
Conservation? Because they're in a district that required
jurisdiction. There's a screening in the back.
Yeah, because it was drainage. Because they're near a wetland.
Oh, no, I was more asking in general.
Oh.
You know, like, do they see only permits that, I don't know.
Well, for example, they have floor drains that have to be installed. And
yeah.
And they have to have a holding tank. Because it's over a door, oil separator.
Yep.
Because it's near a water resource district, they have to get involved in conservation.
Did that trigger their jurisdiction?
Yes.
Okay.
But I thought in the original permit they were not supposed to have more than 100 vehicles. I mean, that then goes.
That's a different issue.
Right, their permit. I know, right? It's a whole bunch of issues on the same lot that they're supposed to be less than 100, but they now move those over to, I don't even know if they're still there. I haven't driven by the old
VFW.
Well, the VFW doesn't have a permit to have the automotive storage there, because under the zoning, automotive needs a special permit.
Well, those are not automotive, technically.
Whatever.
They're campers.
Right, but they need a retail. Aren't they registered vehicles?
They're not sold. They're just.
Yeah, but how do you know that they are not doing the business over here? If somebody, if I go there, I want to see their lease, he will take me there, right?
He takes you over to the VFW.
I've been told when I talked about it, they were not to do that.
Agreed. But how do you
go to enforce? I only got one call from one of the neighbors nearby there, and they just kind of let it go after I forgot how. But that idea was one of them. I didn't think they were supposed to be doing any maintenance or repair of vehicles on the flag site. I thought their permit, original permit they were issued by the selectmen, I thought said they could wash and just do like prettying things up before they send it out. You need to leave that door open. It's a public meeting.
Yeah, well, the backpack.
That's all right. Just leave it open a little bit. That's all right. Thank you. So the idea is they were only supposed to be doing like minor like touch up and that kind of stuff, but now I guess they've got a whole, I haven't been in there, but it looks like they've got a couple of repair bays and they're doing significant work on RVs.
Okay.
So I don't know why.
I'm not sure what their
permit, but someone should be watching that. I'm not sure if the selectmen are.
Okay.
I know one that isn't. So I think that's generally, and we can talk about other stuff. There's a few other ones, but did you have any questions?
almost done.
All right. Have we made any progress on it?
No.
No.
All right. Is anyone? All right. We'll put that on for the second meeting in September. We're not going to do it the first.
But he said it was a unique thing to West Boston. He mean our requirement?
We're more stringent. Is there? I've seen other ones where if there's like a 20,000 square foot building or like.
But they still have that requirement.
Some
it's just that it's bigger.
Yeah. Yep. And they don't have a parking requirement. Everyone has their own little triggers based on how they got burned in the past. That's how all the bylaws get developed. We thought we had things in order, but then it didn't work out, and we had to write a sentence or a couple of paragraphs on something.
To get something specific. And then you end up with a bylaw like the Conservation Commission that gets thrown out.
Right. Right. We never want to have that. It's kind of work to get to there.
Right.
All right. So any reports from other boards?
I've not received any.
No, I told her, but you know what you guys can do? Go on the website. It says subscribe to news. You can put it in and put your email in.
Oh, I've already done it.
I got the agendas.
Yeah, you just
click. There is a thing that you can check off the minutes as well.
Okay.
Go on that. I told her. She said she has no problem doing it, but she said after approved, so you might as well just.
So she was away on vacation for. Oh, yeah. Okay.
She had
them before they're actually posted, because the ones that are posted are old.
No.
No.
We have to get the approved.
Well,
sometimes they change it.
So that's why you might as well sign up and get,
okay.
Once you post it, then it would automatically go to all
your
people.
Okay.
All
right.
But she said she could do it anyway. But I checked the website to see if there was an option to do that.
Okay. I was at the FISP meeting today. So the big news is Senior Center project. There are about five architect firm want to build a building. So out of five, the members chose three of them. And it's going to be an interview. They are going to invite three firms for an interview on next Tuesday.
Wow, that's great. They're moving right along. Good.
So.
And they're all locked in on the same site, right?
Yeah, it's going to be on the same site.
Are there three locals?
Not changing.
Huh?
Local people?
No, this is, one is out in Cambridge. I think it's a public information now.
Yeah.
It was televised. One is the Sterling Associate. It's out of Cambridge. There is this out of company name. So they are in Springfield, I guess. And one is the current president, Mike Snazzy. The people who are doing our police station.
Yeah.
Excellent. That's good. That was moving right along.
So it will be, the interview is going to be on the day. It's an open meeting. So anyone can come in.
So you said they already selected three, they'll pick one on Tuesday?
Yes.
Wow.
After the interview, they will be. Possibly they will. That might be one.
Okay.
So the interview is going to be Tuesday, 7 o'clock.
Did they get somebody to come out from all those firms?
Say again?
Did they get somebody to come out from all
yes.
those firms?
Yes, they will come and
their
group will come.
Yep.
And they will present like 30 minutes or 45 minutes each.
Sounds good. I'm just figuring it out.
Excellent. Any other meetings or?
Oh. Oh, we did have the select board. 3.5 minutes.
Oh, man. We got to beat that. All right. What do you have, Mark?
Affordable Housing Trust is going on heavy trying to get the Sonstedt Gardens lottery working. We're working with them. It's going to be up. Actually, it might be on the website now.
That is the website.
Their website. I'm not sure.
The builder
website. What?
The builder website?
I don't think it's the builder, I think it's the lottery agent, they might have it there, but then as soon as we find out, we were going to give it to the link on our website, but I don't know what's up there.
We were able to adjust the pricing?
No. Well, no, that's crazy.
No longer affordable.
Yeah, right.
Oh, okay.
Makes no sense.
That was it.
All right.
That was going with that lottery.
I think that was it for me.
Who's Drew Jim?
Minutes. We don't have any payments. Oh, is there any other things in here? Or?
No.
You stay as
no,
the
no, no bills.
So, public hearing meeting minutes.
Those are great.
For a site plan review for Bethlehem Bible Church. We have some motion to approve.
I have a motion to approve the public hearing meeting minutes for June 28th, 2017 for the Bethlehem Bible Church site plan review.
Second.